Welcome everybody, and thank you so much for joining the fifth edition, or the sixth edition actually, of Conversation with Green Changemakers in Japan. So as you may know, if you've been on previous talks, the idea of this talk is to bring along passionate individuals to talk about various topics around ecology and well-being. And so today we have the chance to welcome Mona Neos from No Plastic Japan. So to give you a bit of an intro from Mona. So Mona is actually a strategic communication consultant during the day. And she was born between Germany and Japanese parents. But she has spent most of her life in England before moving to Japan in 2016. So she founded No Plastic Japan in 2018. To start raising awareness around our consumption habits and the waste we are creating. And one of the main activities actually she's doing with No Plastic Japan is replacing plastic straw with stainless steel ones for individuals and businesses. So she's collaborating with a variety of stakeholders on different communication and sustainability challenges. So tonight, she will tell us a bit more about her story, how she started No Plastic Japan, and also how she got involved in the creation of the zero waste store nearby Totoya. And she will also give us lots of tips on how to have a plastic-free, and more generally, actually, a waste-free lifestyle in Japan. So don't hesitate to ask lots of questions to her. Thank you so much, Mona, for joining us tonight. So now, the scene is starting with you. So before we go into the meaty discussion, I want to ask you a bit more about, you know, your background, where you're from, and what you do for a living, even though I gave a bit of an intro. If you can tell us a bit more about that, about yourself.
Hi, everyone. Good evening. So self-intro. I mean, you covered it well. You know, that's kind of everything I do, but to recap a little bit, yeah, so I am half German, half Japanese, but grew up in the UK and I've been here for 4 years, and I moved over for a new job, and which I'm still employed. I still work as a communications consultant, but I'm on maternity leave, which gave me more time to focus on the other things I've been doing. Main thing being No Plastic Japan, which I started 2 years ago, but also consulting in other areas of sustainability with other companies now. So No Plastics Japan started as almost a way for me to bring other voices together. It started with, I wouldn't say an incident, but I was in a cafe which focused on organic foods, etc., which I associate also with ecological things. I think it's not just for our health, but they used a lot of single-use plastics in store, and I reached out to them to ask them to, you know, if it's just a cup of water, maybe we can just have it in a glass. But I felt like I'm signing that email off as just me, whereas there's a lot of other people that feel that way, but I had no other way to, you know, express it. So I thought, okay, well, you know, even just to get this kind of voice somehow, I kind of started No Plastic Japan, and mainly I post on Instagram. And I would say, you know, there's a community around that, with the kind of stainless steel straw being the item that people post and talk about and use. But, you know, I think 2 years really made a big difference. And I'm not saying just because of me, but generally there's a lot bigger community now of people involved in environmental things. So that's in sum my little journey so far.
Makes sense. And so, so how and when did you become aware of the issue with, let's say, climate change and plastic pollution? And how did you really spark something in you?
Yeah, I think, you know, I wonder if everyone feels the same way, because I think a lot of international people on this call right now. But the idea of carrying your own bags to a shop or having your own water bottle, that wasn't really new to me. You know, I've had that at university, I've had that at school. So it wasn't really like I was doing that for the environment necessarily. But coming here, I didn't see many people do that around me. And just working in a regular office, you know, there was colleagues that would go to the konbini downstairs, get a bag, get a bento, get a plastic fork, etc. And, you know, just seeing how those get thrown away after that lunchtime, I think so moving to Japan was definitely one trigger to realize that whatever I was doing subconsciously wasn't even a thing here. And especially because I've been to Japan many times, but just as a, well, tourist, I suppose. I was here to see family, but, you know, I never saw it as a place to live. So I would just go shopping as a regular tourist, you know, buy all the, how do you say, kind of the seasonal sweets or whatever, you know, I was just like a regular person. But when you actually move here and do your shopping in accordance to kind of the daily life and see all that waste, it's definitely different to just being a tourist here.
Yeah, for sure. Mm. And actually, so can you tell us a bit more about your personal journey on trying to reduce your waste? Like, what are your tips for plastic-free shopping in Japan?
Yeah, so I think it depends on where you go shopping in terms of supermarket. I think some are better than others. So I would say the standard things that I need to get, I would go to a normal supermarket near ours. There's a few things you can get plastic free at all times, I would say. In our place, for example, it's cucumbers, tomatoes, broccoli. Those things are usually plastic free, so, you know, if I need those, that's pretty easy. I don't eat meat at home, so I've not cooked meat in 6 years maybe, so I kind of avoid that whole aisle, which makes it easier to, you know, avoid all those sort of trays and sort of things. So yeah, in that sense, there's a few things I don't buy anyway. And then when it comes to other things, recently, I guess since lockdown, I've kind of thought about how to shop a little bit more as well. I recently decided to order a veggie box on a regular basis, which comes from Chiba. So it's not too far away. Of course, there's a shipping, which adds to, you know, kind of environmental burden, but I think supporting small farmers that focus on natural organic farming, that to me seemed more important right now than thinking about the cost of shipping. So I've been doing that right now. It comes in paper, you know, just wrapped in paper and so on. So that's been really interesting. And I think we might talk about it later as well, but I'm part of a team that runs a zero waste shop in Tokyo on Sundays right now. So the reason it's Sunday is because we only do it as a model shop. So we don't really want our shop to become bigger or for us to have like franchises or anything. It's more that we want to present what an ideal sort of zero waste shop is, basically. And by having that and trying new things out in our shop, we then share that knowledge with other people that want to start a shop that has a bulk buy section, or they already have a shop and they want to, you know, have a different corner for it. So that's kind of what I do. And there you can buy things like pasta, you can buy olive oil, you can buy nuts, all those sort of things package free. So I just bring my own containers for those.
That's nice. Yeah, I'd love to talk more about that. But before we move on to that, I wanted to ask you, because something I notice sometimes, and you mentioned actually the veggie box, which is a great way to avoid that. But some of the items which are organic are usually wrapped in plastic, even the most simple like vegetables, because I guess they don't want it to be kind of mixed together. So that's kind of one of the challenges I find here, like trying to compromise between reducing your waste or, you know, protecting the soils and your health. So it's kind of challenging, I find.
Yeah, no, definitely, definitely. And I always say this to people when these sort of topics come up, you know, that environmental things, let's say, like all those challenges that we're facing, there's not really always a simple answer. And in Japan, I feel like sometimes, you know, people really look for an answer from someone who has an influence, let's say. And I get a lot of questions on, you know, what product is better, or what do you think about this product? Is it good? Is it bad for the environment? But I think, like you said, you know, sometimes you just have to compromise, and there's not always one answer of what's better or what's worse. And I feel that especially in Japan, I suppose, yeah, you have to either go for the organic that's packaged or the one that's not packaged. And it just kind of becomes a personal choice on what's environmentally friendly or what, you know, what then aligns with your values as well.
That's true, yeah. Mm. And I feel also in Japan, because maybe it's not as widespread as in other countries, like the bulk shopping is actually quite challenging because except for your model shop, you usually have to pick and mix from different shops, actually. So.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah, I do that as well. Yeah, like kind of mix the supermarkets where I know, you know, you can buy this here and yeah, you kind of just mix it up. But going on the bulk shopping part, in Japan, I don't know. To be honest, I wasn't really interested in bulk shopping when I was in London, so I can't really compare. But there's certain things like miso paste, tofu, rice that you can still buy in bulk in Japan. And so that's kind of, you know, we talk about zero waste shopping as if it's something new, but if anything, it's something that we're bringing back, I would say. Yeah, so the kind of old school places, they still do buy bulk, basically. Yeah.
Yes. That's true. So you started talking a bit about the store you were part of. Can you tell us a bit more how you started this project and, you know, the beginning of it?
Yeah, so it was only about a year and 2 months ago, I think, where this topic even came up. So I met the lady who owns Totoya, which is an importer of organic produce to Japan. But during the import, she's very passionate about making sure that, I mean, she meets all the producers, the growers of the foods and whatever. So she knows exactly who's producing it. So she makes sure that they try their best to basically send it over without excessive packaging. Basically, of course, there's packaging because it's, you know, we have to send it somehow, but it might be a large bag that can be reused, like a kind of, how do you say, like nuts, for example, we get in 25 kilo bulks. So that might come in like a big paper bag that can be reused, or cardboard or something like that. So anyway, I met this lady, yeah, just over a year ago. She approached me whether I want to be part of the zero waste market that they were running at the UNU farmers market. So it would have been a separate section of it. And yeah, she wanted to see if I wanted to sell my straws there. And I wasn't available for the first one, but I met her for the second one. And yeah, we were just chatting. We were selling vegetables there as well. So it was kind of a small store where we sold my items. We sold some vegetables, package free, because I'm sure some people here have been to the UNU market, but the farmer's market here is not necessarily what you might imagine abroad. It's still packaged and not always, it's getting better, but yeah, so it's not necessarily zero waste. And we were providing that kind of zero waste area in the market. And yeah, we were just talking and she said, you know, it'd be great if we could have more of this in a shop and so on. And I was like, yeah, I'm up for it. And it was really as simple as that. 2 months later, we opened on the Sunday. So we were renting out a space of a friend of hers. And yeah, it was really quick like that. And since then, we've had new members join us. Someone who's doing kind of the more accounting side, someone who's doing the business development. So it's a small team of just four of us. But yeah, we're really kind of trying to see, there's a lot of people that want to help out. So sometimes we do have people volunteering as well. But yeah, that's kind of how it all started.
Oh, that's nice. And so what kind of customer actually do you get? Like, is it like international people or Japanese, local people?
It's a mix of everything. We do get a lot of people come with the intention of shopping there. So they come with their bags, they come with their containers, which is super helpful to us because we actually don't provide anything. So we don't provide any packaging that is single use. So no paper bags either. So, you know, whenever someone kind of comes unprepared, what we can provide is we sell these organic cotton bags, like produce bags that you can reuse. Or we have what we call community jars. So pasta sauce jars, for example, we take them in from other people that, you know, have them lying around the house and we clean them and then provide them as containers that people can use. But yeah, so a lot of people come prepared, basically. So people that were really looking for the zero waste shopping, a lot of people message us like, you know, I'm going to come from this other prefecture, et cetera, et cetera. So I would say a majority of customers, we spend at least 10 minutes talking. It's not really a shop where you go in, bye, goodbye. It's a lot of conversation on, yeah, zero waste lifestyle. And yeah, and then sometimes we have local people that live near your yogi that come because they're curious. And we've had actually mainly just positive feedback. You know, when we explain what the shop is about, they say, yeah, you know what, I'm just going to carry in my bag then, or like, I'll come back with my container or something. Mm. So,
and yeah. Do you feel like they understand the point and they're changing things in the way they approach what they do?
Yeah, I think so. I think it might just be the people that live there. You know, I think there's a certain type of personality that might live around Yoyogi, but a lot of people, when we explain why we do it, that it's not just you know, inconvenience. They're very open to it, and they say, oh yeah, you know, yeah, it's great because there's a lot of waste, and we're like, yep. So yeah, no, it's been very accepted, I think.
That's great. And actually, what was the impact of COVID on this shop and the way people approach bulk buying? Did you see a difference?
So for our shop, we were closed, I think it was for a couple months, April. Oh no, we weren't closed. So we shifted our hours, made it shorter, made it on a Friday night, just so that we're really open only for necessary things. You know, after work, you pop in, you buy what you need. Because, you know, it's a shame that environmentally friendly businesses have to cut down on their work while, you know, other things are packaged excessively. But we also started a delivery service during those 2 months, April and May, it was actually a test for us as well, whether we could ship things zero waste. And I think it's important to say that zero waste, I think, has different definitions. People think about it differently. For us, it was, you know, let's say the zero waste delivery was reusing cardboard boxes that we found in places or people gave us. We had a returnable system for any liquidy things. So we sold, I think we had honey and olive oil and anything sticky like dried berries, we put in jars that people paid deposits for. Or there was the option to kind of buy it as well. And then we had the cotton bags that they could also send back. So it was a good way for us to see if this actually would work. Although it's on a small scale, you know, we would be packing it up and sending it. So that's kind of what we did during COVID. Yeah.
Mm. And do you feel like deposit, you know, with the online shipping as a right to succeed? Was it successful as an experiment?
I would say as an experiment, yes. But I think if it's to take off, you need a bigger system. You need a facility to wash the containers properly, just to save time and so on. It was definitely not efficient on our side. So I think it would not be us that would, you know, create the system. I think what we try to do is really collaborate with other businesses and other, other people that already have these things going. So, you know, this is really ideal, but I really think if a convenience chain would start this sort of deposit system, whether it's for cups or containers, you know, like there's a convenience everywhere. So that would be ideal. And so I think for us, we find it easier and more efficient if we can work with some other people on things like this.
Makes sense. And so you were saying as part of this business, you're also providing some kind of consulting. So is it also something you've been discussing maybe with partners like companies, or is it, how does it work?
Yeah, so there's a few things moving that I probably can't talk about yet, but
that's okay.
No, but it's we've been working with different businesses. For example, we've worked with we're working with, I would say, one of the largest Japanese businesses that sell scales or like scaling systems. So we have a scale in our shop right now that, you know, makes it a lot easier for us to sell in bulk, because there's a lot of things like, you know, weighing the container first, taking that weight off, etc. So how to make that more efficient. So these are some of the sort of things we're trying in our shop to then tell other people that have these shops to how to make improvements. So in that sense, we're partnering with them and they're providing it for us for free because they want to go more environmentally friendly and suggest those things to their partners as well. So yeah, we have things like that. Or some of the products that we have cookies that a kind of bakery team, not within us, but another company. They make zero waste cookies for us. They deliver zero waste to us. They only use our products, so we know it's zero waste in that sense. So things like that we're testing out.
Well, that's great, actually. There's a question about Unimarket. Did you feel like other people were also, you know, interested by your initiatives and looking at decreasing their packaging?
So this was a huge thing that we were really trying to get to at the UNU market. So we had this zero waste naked market, we called it, for about 4 or 5 months. Every month we had it, and we involved other producers or other sellers to be part of it. But we, you know, our criteria was basically don't provide any packaging to people. Don't just unwrap as you come to the market, you know, come as zero waste, basically. And that was working well until they said, and I don't mean this to be, you know, kind of like a they and us, but the farmers felt a bit pressured by having this kind of separate market that was doing it so kind of extremely, let's say, because there were farmers that said, you know, we can't stop wrapping it if it means that things wilt and people don't buy it. And I totally understand that, you know, it's a challenge, and there's no need to, you know, we don't want to put them at risk of not doing well in their business. So there was a bit of a thing like that, and now the farmers market then decided not to provide any plastic bags anymore. But to be honest, you know, that's a movement of the government as well, so in that sense it kind of was at the same time. And yeah, I think farmers were basically interested, but they didn't know always how to do it best. And we were happy to provide that information, but I think we weren't able to have that kind of interaction with them directly. I think it's always a thing of economics and versus, you know, zero waste. You have to ensure that it works both ways, that businesses don't just go down because of it.
Yeah, it makes sense. Yeah. And so do you feel that actually having unpackaged goods is impacting the business? Like, you know, consumers will not buy something because it's unpackaged?
I mean, personally, you know, I go for the opposite. I obviously go for the unpackaged. But as I was talking to the people at the Scales company today, actually, they said, yeah, like, especially during COVID, people will choose packaged ones over unpackaged, or sometimes they people try to take the ones that are underneath so that it's not been touched by other people, etc., which I find funny because you kind of wash vegetables right before you eat them. But so I think, you know, I think people listening here and also myself might be in a bubble of people that are interested in a more eco-friendly lifestyle. So I always kind of get a bit eco-chambered, you know, I kind of think, oh, everyone must be looking for zero waste items and ways of shopping. But I need to remind myself that it's really not the case when you step out of it. So I think it's a slow progress on, you know, making people think that that's the better product. Because I can see why it might seem like it's more clean when it's packaged and so on as well.
Mm. And so do you feel like you have develop strategies of communication to actually explain to people and find a way to change their kind of preconception about that?
I think things like hygiene around food and stuff, I think that's really hard, and it's been very difficult around COVID. I think there is, you know, Starbucks obviously was the first to say no to bringing your own cups, for example, and I've had many sort of smaller cafes tell me, oh, well, we're doing it because, you know, Starbucks is doing it too, as if, you know, some sort of standard that they're providing. And then it's hard to argue, you know, because my argument is, well, I wash my cup, it's fine. If I get anything, it's not your fault. But from their side, they're like, oh, just in case. So you can't really argue this kind of scientific stuff just in a shop, right? So that's been a little bit tricky, but what I try to do when I refuse things in shops, like, you know, the tiny bags that you get to put vegetables in, they kind of, you know, put it in for you sometimes. I try not to just say that I don't need it, but I try to say why, which I think is really important to say, you know, I don't need it because I'm trying to reduce my waste or things like that. I think that kind of communication is really important to make people understand why you're doing things. And same with, you know, refusing a straw. You say, I don't need it because I'm trying to cut waste, I have my own, or something like that, just to get a bit of a conversation going or get people thinking about it.
That makes sense, actually. I wanted to ask you, because you actually recently had a young baby, so maybe there's some parents in the audience, and so sometimes this can be a challenging time because you're very busy, and actually babies can generate a lot of waste. How do you deal with that situation, and what are the things you've managed to do and to actually let go of?
Yeah, I think once you have a baby, you kind of have to let go of some of the battles. What I've been doing in terms of baby zero waste stuff, I've been using cloth nappies predominantly. I say predominantly because there's been times where we go out and I know, you know, we're on a train or something and it's going to be hours. Then I use, like diapers, regular diapers. But cloth nappies. And then also we use like organic cotton cloths instead of single use butt wipes. And that's been working super easy. You know, all you do is wash them. And I think, again, it's kind of this perception that something's cleaner if you can throw away. Sure, maybe. But I think there's something else. Like, I think there's a bit of, it just feels nicer, I think. It feels a little more cared for and kind of a bit warmer to kind of use something that you don't just throw away. And, you know, I think if we were throwing away diapers every day, like our bin would be full like immediately. So it's been, in that sense, it's been nicer. I think it feels like I have more time for other things because I don't have to think about the trash all the time. So those two things we've been cutting waste on. I don't know what other things there are that, you know, produce waste.
I guess that's the big ones, to be honest. And actually, you know, I wanted to ask you, because a lot of people sometimes, you know, give the argument that actually washing something uses a lot of energy, a lot of water, so it's not necessarily better. What do you say to these people?
I actually think it's relatively simple that water and energy could be renewable. So I think if you change your energy provider to a renewable electricity kind of thing, then in some sense it's renewable. So I think personally, I think wasting materials is more than wasting water or energy. But again, I think you can argue it. I think nappies, for example, apparently they didn't biodegrade for like 400, or not even biodegrade, but like degrade for 400 years or something. So of course, I'm not just throwing it into the ocean, it's different, but I don't think it can be that good for the environment, even if you just burn it in Japan.
Yeah. And also something that people might not be aware is it's actually full of chemicals, most of them. So you're also kind of harming your baby in a way without knowing it.
Yeah. So I think that's a really interesting topic, that kind of what it does to your body. You know, I think it, in a simple way, whatever's bad for the environment tends to be bad for you as well. But excuse me. Yeah, no, it's a tricky thing. I think I can't tell people to use cloth nappies all the time. You know, it's a personal choice. But I've been trying that for now.
And I think from hearing from some friends, sometimes it can be challenging, you know, with leaking and things like that. So it's a bit of a more logistics sometimes. So yeah. I guess it's a compromise always, like you were saying.
Yeah, I think, you know, I think during motherhood, you just have to be kind to yourself as well. You can't do everything perfectly. But if you were to just change it even once a day to the cloth nappies, you know, that could save a few. So yeah, I kind of look at it like that.
That's true. There's another topic I saw you were doing, which I find really interesting, which is composting.
Oh yeah.
So what kind of compost do you have, and how long have you had it for, and how did it start?
So I use an EM composting. So like I have a box, like a bin basically, and it has a nozzle at the bottom so you can get the moisture out.
Oh.
All you do is you put the scraps in, and then you put a bit of I should know the word for this, but it's kind of like rice bran and other things that kind of break it down quicker. So yeah, and then you have a bit of liquid come out every now and then, it basically gets fermented in the box. And then after that, you put it into soil.
Okay. Is it different from bokashi, or is it
similar? Oh, yeah. No, that's it. That's it.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Makes sense.
But I recently actually have bought another one that I want to try. And I've been very dubious about it because it kind of, it's not zero waste. You get like a bag for it. It's like a zipped bag. Mm. And then they send you this kind of specially mixed soil. And you can have it maybe also indoors, but apparently it's super simple. And I've been struggling a little bit with my compost outside, especially during the hot weather. So I wanted to give this one a try. So it's a kind of like a testing thing for me right now. And we have a lot of food scraps in a sense that we eat mainly vegetables. So I kind of, most of our waste is that. So it does actually fill up quickly. Bananas, for example. Yeah,
makes sense. Somebody is asking actually, where do you put the soil that you produce? Because some people live in apartments, so this person is actually living in an apartment with a backyard, but how do you manage that?
So I have then just either just left it in the box still, I haven't used up everything, or I've planted them, like used planters basically to try and plant vegetables. It hasn't been going that well, but yeah. But there's also a new project. sorry, I've got something in my throat. In Omotesando, where you can bring your soil to the place as a community space.
Oh, nice. If you remember the name, I will share that in the newsletter chapter.
Yes. Yeah, I'll send it to you. Yeah.
I think there's also a composting community in Shibuya area, which is called Cats Urban Compost.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So yeah. I think you guys can also get in touch with them if you need to dispose of some soil. But what I found, I don't know for you, but usually like I put so much in my compost and they degrade and they also kind of compact themselves. Uh-huh. So there's not that much actually that, you know, actually stays.
Right, and if you use a bokashi, it's pretty quick. Like when you then put it in soil, it's kind of gone within maybe like a week or two. Yeah, it's relatively quick.
So yes, really recommend. Even in flats, like compost are easy to maintain.
Yeah, it's like a trial and error. I think, you know, it's not going to be perfect from the start. No. but yeah, with anything, you know, like just try it. I mean, you know, I feel like better to try and then decide not to do it than not try at all.
That's true.
Yeah,
that's true. So I don't know if there's other things like you can share in terms of plastic-free lifestyle in Japan.
I mean, I wonder, like, I wonder if any of these things that I talk about are unusual. You know, like I'm sure people here listening are, you know, relatively eco-minded, so I might not be talking anything sort of new. But I can also talk about, I mean, the straw movement, for example, like, you know, globally, it's not anything new. I feel like it's kind of been happening for a couple of years. Excuse me. But in Japan, it's really kind of taken off maybe the last year or so. I mean, the number of people that post about it, let's say, and that sounds like a very sort of non kind of, you know, solid data, but the kind of amount of people that talk about having their own straws or refusing it, or all these new accounts coming up with really good content on how to be more environmentally friendly. It's really, yeah, like last few months really kind of picked up, especially young people in Japan, like students, they're really active in this space. So I don't know, I think, you know, we tend to kind of package Japan as like, oh my god, so much packaging, but there's I think a really good movement happening right now of young people looking for change.
That's great. And what do you think has driven that change, you know, to spark, you know, amongst the, for example, the student community?
Yeah, it's hard to say. I think like the movement of Greta, for example, that's really kind of come over here as well on this Fridays for Future in Tokyo and other places. Other than that, I do wonder, I'm not sure. I mean, I feel like the global movement does kind of influence Japan. I think the approach is a little bit different, even with my straws, you know, I mean, first of all, I don't my aim is not really to sell the straws. I mean, yes, of course, that's part of the business, but I don't really advertise or anything, just because I want people to, only the people that want it to buy it. But it's, I think it's become a bit of a fashion statement sometimes, which is, you know, not what I'm aiming for, but it's relatively effective, I think, for Japan to make it a trend. So that's probably very different to like, say, Europe. But I mean, I've only kind of been in Europe. But yeah, I think there's more of like a, it's something else, like to be politically active, for example, is statement itself. But in Japan, it's not so much yet. So I think the straw is more of like a fashion statement for some people. But, you know, if that's what it is to get them started and more interested, then that's, yeah, that's one.
I guess, yeah, it's always a good way to start, whatever the way, as long as the result is there.
yeah. Hopefully it doesn't end on a trend, you know. I hope this is not just a fad, but yeah, I always say, you know, whatever your entrance is, because, you know, we shouldn't all forget that at one point we were all not eco-friendly, probably. I saw a photo of, you know, my phone kind of said 4 years ago, whatever, you know, this on this day kind of thing. I just had like a takeout Starbucks thing, and I was like, oh wow, 4 years ago, like, you know, I used to just get single-use things. So, you know, I think you need to remain humble sometimes, just to remember your, you know, where you came from kind of thing. Yeah, so I kind of try to remind myself of that, and yeah,
I think you're right. I wonder, like, I think there's also in Japan something that is a bit challenging, I guess we talked about that, but the konbini culture with this convenience and everything that is also maybe not helping, because it's so convenient today to just go into the konbini and buy something, or even the bentos. And so yeah, I think there's something there that's maybe difficult to change in terms of ways.
Yeah, it is. And I think zero waste things shouldn't be less convenient. You know, ideally we don't just say you have to sacrifice all these things so that you can save the environment, but hopefully there's a way that is even better maybe than your convenience. And yeah, Japan in particular, it's a selling point, you know, convenience, good services. But I think it's overstepped itself a little bit. I don't think a lot of people are really looking for that level of service in terms of, you know, all this packaging and whatever. So I think it's changing, but it's yeah, it's hard to argue against convenience. I think people can't really let that go.
Yeah, that's true. Actually, somebody's asking where we can buy your straws, you know, online, or, you know, can they be found in some stores in Tokyo, for example?
Yeah, so I have an online store. If you just look up noplasticjapan.com, I sell them online, but there's also plenty of shops that sell them in store, so you can actually pick them up and look at them. There's a locations map that I have on the website where you can see all the shops that use it in store or that sell it as well. In Tokyo, the biggest one will be Loft in Ginza. They have a section downstairs where they have my straws. Yeah. So there's a few places.
Great, nice. So I don't know, guys, don't hesitate if you have more questions. So we are getting close to the end. I wanted to ask you actually if you had some resources like books, documentaries, podcasts, or anything that you can recommend on ecology or zero waste. Anything.
I wonder. I mean, these days I really get a lot of information from Instagram, and I know it sounds like, you know, not very scientific to get stuff off social media, but there's just so much new stuff now, like so many new projects, so many new people doing things, and I think at the beginning I was looking at it as like plastic free. I think that was kind of the keyword that I was working towards. That then shifted more towards zero waste. And I think as of recent, I've been even more interested in climate change. I mean, of course, that was always a goal in a sense that you reduce single-use plastic, you use less, you know, oils and, you know, et cetera. It all leads to climate change, of course. But yeah, I think I've been kind of less talking less about it. And I think that was kind of a conscious decision, because I didn't think going in so hard, let's say, on reducing waste would ring well with Japanese people, just because it was still a new topic. But I think as more and more the community grows, I'm trying to remind people that, you know, we're not just doing this as like, oh, you know, let's not use plastic. I think it goes beyond that. It's not like you don't use plastic, but you can use paper bags and throw them away, you know. So I'm trying to be a little bit more holistic nowadays. So yeah, and I get a lot of information from Instagram. There's a lot of people posting great things these days. Maybe not enough in English and Japanese. So yeah, I do try to be the bridge if I can, posting in both languages whenever possible.
Makes sense. By the way, I will ask you for the details of your favorite accounts, and I will send that, add that to the article so that people can have a look.
Great.
And so some people were asking, there will be a recording of the session for people who are not able to join. And even people who join, you will have access to the recording and an article and everything. Give me a few days to do the editing and you will get everything. There's actually a really interesting comment. So someone was talking with a greengrocer that said that having plastic around veggies gets the customers to pick up the products and increasing the likelihood of purchasing. And so this guy is thinking about like keeping the plastic and then reusing, you know, giving out the vegetables and reusing. Do you think like Japanese consumers would respond well to that from your experience?
I see. So I guess at the checkout, take it out and then hand it over. I don't know. I mean, I think that's kind of what goes into the economics of it. You know, if it's that inefficient to do that at the checkout, I don't know if that's a good thing. And I don't know if it'll come across like a good thing. Like, you know, I think the people buying it would be like, well, why are we going through all this? But I think having maybe two options, like packaged, unpackaged as a start, or having discounts for not buying the packaged ones. I think there's ways to entice people to go for the unpackaged. You know, it could be a better deal, perhaps, if you buy that. Yeah. So I think I'm not sure about kind of taking it out at the cashier and then handing it over. But even just, you know, leaving out a sign to say that that is an option, maybe, because I think a lot of people, they don't want to ask, you know, like it's, yeah, they don't want to ask if they can do certain things. But if the shop provides these options, I think that's a good way to do it.
There's another question actually, what to do above and beyond reduction of plastic use and composting? What should a committed person do actually?
Well, I think the main thing, I know maybe not the main thing, but a huge thing that you could do, and super easy thing you could do, in reducing CO2 emissions, is just to change your energy provider. And it's so easy to do. It takes 5 minutes, basically. If you have if you have the number of your electricity bill, you just put those things in. And there's a lot of companies, of course, that do renewable energy, so you have to kind of choose. But super easy. And apparently, is it about half of your CO2 emissions in your kind of lifestyle comes from energy? So I just think, yeah, that's probably the best thing to do. And I'm actually, well, I'm working on, and it's taking some time, baby's taking some time these days, but I'm working on creating like a English language guideline, not guideline, but like a guide basically, on how to be more eco-friendly, and things like that come into play as well. And I've been talking to some energy companies that currently don't have English information on how to switch their energies. So yeah, I want things like that to be more accessible to English speakers as well.
That's great. What is your favorite energy provider for green energy in Japan?
I've gone for Minna Denryoku, which I've gone for because they are about making energy visible. So they have photos of the people that make the energy. Kind of like, you know, when you get a picture of someone who made your vegetables, basically, because they know that energy is so hard to imagine. You know, where does your electricity come from? Like, it's very hard to imagine. So they try to make it of a more transparent thing. And I really like that. But there's other companies like Shizen Energy. There's plenty. But yeah.
Good. There's a question around more like, an observation about like, how can we help maybe or the people in Japan to change the mindset from just a trend to something more long-term and more, I guess, ingrained?
Yeah, no, that's a very good question. I think what I tried to do, and I've had times where I wasn't like that, when I started No Plastic Japan and started talking about these things and posting on Instagram, there definitely was the urge to point companies out that were not doing things, or point cafes out that were super ridiculous in their single-use items. But I think it doesn't sit so well in Japan, like kind of this name and shame type thing, which I see a lot in, you know, other countries, and it works. You know, companies get blamed for things, they might change. But in Japan, I think that is not so much a culture. So to make things long term, or to make things to make people realize that this is a good thing to shift for more eco things, I think it's better to be more positive. So what I try to do these days is show positive examples of changes. And I think doing that will change businesses, which in turn impact consumers. Obviously, it can go the other way as well. But that kind of, yeah, lifting up the good examples, I think that's very good. But saying that, my last post is calling out Muji for their ridiculous bulk buying thing, which you guys can check out. But, you know, sometimes it's necessary. Yeah. So I think for it not to be a trend is to show that it's not a trend, you know, it's to show that, you know, companies have made commitments or there's big changes. Talking about those things, I think, is important.
Makes sense. Cool. Mm-hmm. So I think we've reached 8 o'clock. Thank you so much, everyone, for all your good questions. And thank you so much, Bona, for taking the time to being there and sharing about your experience. I think it was super interesting. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, if you want to reach Bona, so you just go on Instagram. I will actually add now like the Instagram handle if you want to follow her, and you also have the website. You can.
Yeah, I would love to know what people want to know more of as I create the guide, which might take ages. Sorry, but you know, I'm just curious what are the challenges, especially as a non-Japanese speaker being in Japan. So yeah, I'd love to hear.
So yeah, don't hesitate to share with us.
Yeah.
Perfect. So yes, that's it. Thank you, everyone. Have a great evening.
Thank you.
And, we see you next month for the next event.
Thanks very much.
Bye, guys. Thank you.